And many of the Hindus have a misconception that Hinduism prohibits a human being from having non-veg food. If you read the scriptures of the Hindus, in several scriptures, several places says that sages, saints had non-veg food. If you read Manusmriti, chapter number 5, verse number 30, it says that the eater, if he eats the flesh of the thing which is to be eaten, then it is good. Even if he does it day after day, because God has created some to be eaten and some to become eater. When you read Manusmriti, chapter number 5, verse number 31, it says that eating meat in sacrifice is not a sin. It is the law of the gods. It's mentioned in Manusmriti, chapter number 5, verse number 39, as well as 40, that God created sacrificial animals. So killing animals in sacrifice is not considered as killing. Furthermore, when you read Mahabharata, Anushasan Parv, chapter number 88, regarding the Pandavas, the five brothers, the eldest brother Yudhishthir, he asks Bhishma that while they were doing puja, yagna for the ancestors, he asks Bhishma that what should we give in puja, in yagna, so that our ancestors will be satisfied. So Bhishma replies that if you put in the puja herbs, vegetables and fruits, the ancestors will be satisfied for 1 month. If you give fish, 2 months. If you give meat, 3 months. If you give hair, 4 months. If you give meat of the goat, 5 months. If you give bacon, meat of the pig, 6 months. If you give birds, 7 months. If you give deer, 8 months. And the menu continues. If you give a buffalo, 11 months. And if you give cow, our ancestors will be satisfied for 1 full year. That is beef. And if you give rhinoceros meat or red meat of goat, our ancestors will be satisfied inexhaustibly. There's a big menu, imagine. Vegetables, fish, meat, hair, what, everything is there in the menu. So if you read the Hindu scriptures, it was permitted to have non-veg. It is later on, when the Hindus were being influenced by other non-Hindus and tried to take their philosophy, that they converted and tried to make the religion into vegetarianism, though all Hindus aren't vegetarians. Now when we ask these people that why are you a vegetarian, they tell us that killing animal is a sin, because killing living creatures is a sin. So I said, I agree with you. If a person can live without killing living creatures, I'm with you. Today, science tells us that even the plants have got life. Previously, people did not know that plants and vegetables had life. So now the logic has changed. No, we understand, we realize plants have got life, but plants can't feel pain. Therefore, killing animal is a bigger sin as compared to killing a plant. Now science has further advanced and we have come to know that even the plants can feel pain. Though we cannot hear the cry of the plant, but even the plants can feel pain. They don't have a very well-developed system, but they can feel pain. And there was a research done in America that a farmer had made a gadget where you could make the cry of the plant be heard to the human ear. Because the human ear only hears between 20 cycles to 20,000 cycles per second. Anything below and above this, the human being can't hear. Like this is below 20 cycles, I can't hear. If I do fast, I can hear because it's above 20 cycles. You know, the dogs, they can hear up to 40,000 cycles per second. So you may have heard about the silent dog whistle. You blow the whistle, the frequency is between 20,000 and 40,000 cycles per second. The human beings can't hear, the dog here and comes to the master. So the cry of the plant cannot be heard by the human being. So there was a research done in America where a farmer makes a gadget, and whenever the plant wanted more water, it would cry out, used to convert the cry and he could hear it. So today, science tells us that even the plants can feel pain. So now, there is a non-Muslim who argued with Maxim. He said, okay, Brother Zakir, I agree with you that plants have got life, the plants can feel pain. But you know, plants have got about 2 senses less as compared to animals. Animals have got 5 senses, plants have got 3 senses. So I say, okay, for sake of argument, I agree with you. The plants have got 3 senses, animal has got 5 senses. So I ask him the question that suppose if you have a brother who's born deaf and dumb, and if someone comes and kills him, will you go and tell the judge, me Lord, give this murderer less punishment because my brother had 2 senses less? In fact, you'll go and tell the judge, give this murderer double punishment. My brother was masoom, could not hear, could not speak. Give him double punishment. So where is the logic, 2 senses less, so less punishment? In Islam, it does not work 2 senses less or 2 senses more. Quran says in Surah Baqarah chapter 2 verse 168, eat of the things which are good and halal for you. What is permitted and what is good you can have. So what is halal, what is lawful, and what is permitted and what is good you can have. As far as non-Muslims who are against eating non-veg, you know, if I agree that fine, we should not kill any animals, you know, the population of the cattle, it grows so fast that if we stop eating animals, there'll be overpopulation of cattle in the world. So now we have overpopulation of human beings in some countries, India, China. We'll have problem with overpopulation of cattle. And personally, if non-Muslims don't have non-veg, I've got no problem. Believe me, I've got no problem. Because if in India, all the non-Muslims start having non-veg, then maybe the price of mutton and beef will go up. So for me, no problem. If they don't have non-veg, I've got no problem. But if someone tells me that eating non-veg is haram, it's a sin, that's the time I give all this logical explanation.